Hello and welcome back to KubeCon CloudNativeCon North America 2025 from moderately warm Atlanta. We're starting to warm up. We're definitely warmed up on stage here. We have some great stuff. We're continuing the train and talking about AI and making AI real. And I'm really excited to have Amit Eyal Govrin, who's the CEO of Kubiya and one of the co-founders as well. So welcome on board again. It's been a little bit. We've talked in Atlanta about 6 months ago. London. Where are we today? I mean,
apparently Atlanta.
It feels like London. The weather's not cooperating yet.
Definitely.
But great to have you on, Amit.
Thanks for having me back, Rob. It's always been a very interesting checkpoint in terms of where the industry benchmarking, how fast we're running, and seeing where everything's evolving.
So give us kind of a little bit of an update on what's been going on with Kubiya since London.
Absolutely. I think one of the things I'm going to take from this conversation is we're not going to talk about the enterprise stack, even though that exists, right? We can go down a very deep path and a rabbit hole around zero trust architecture with agents, distributed compute, durability of the execution. We can go down that path, but that's not where I want to take it. We've actually understood from all of our engagements that the industry, in order to adopt AI, needs to take it the opposite way. It needs to abstract away these complexities and put it in the hands of stakeholders and business owners who actually can know and to prompt the AI to actually receive those outcomes and to drive positive ROI from their projects. Not just to go into over-engineer these projects, which we're accustomed to seeing with some frameworks out there.
Yeah, I mean, again, we were talking a little bit beforehand, and I think, everybody is kind of trying to figure out. I was at the Infrastructure as Code conference, IAC Conf Connect, on Monday night doing a panel, and one of the things that came up, and it was a room full of platform engineers, and they're like,
sure.
The complexity of running these AI systems and getting from POC to production was just such an immense amount of mental toil for a lot of these people. Mm-hmm. That, and how do you keep engineers productive and working in the right direction? But also, a big piece of it was, how do they, not become a statistic like that MIT statistic that, basically, yes, 95% are not getting from POC to production. I think a lot of that has to do with there's just no ROI done up front. Help people understand where you guys are approaching this differently.
Absolutely. You reference a few. You definitely reference a few talking points we should cover. The first one around the platform engineering side. We really originated from platform engineering. What we understood that platform engineering should not be treated as its own unique segment. It should be treated as a necessary part of the process of deploying AI in production. And I think platform engineers oftentimes like to over-engineer and over-complex because everybody wants their own flavor, just like they did with the backstage approach. Everybody wants their own IDP. So in this case, everybody wants to host their own models. Everybody wants to run their own inference. Everybody wants to run their own frameworks, and that gets everybody in trouble because there's no standard of how we can do so. So where we understood, and we had to take that step back, because we looked at our customers, they were starting to get a little out of sorts in terms of where should we start, can we go and introduce this framework, and of course you can, it's framework agnostic. But let's solve the problem first. What are you actually looking to do? Step back. Engineering velocity. You're trying to go from point A to point B fast. You can do so on a microcosm of a workflow or an agent and get your engineers to code faster. But what happens with that code, once it has to go into reach production, you move the bottleneck upstream.
Right.
So you never actually solve the engineering velocity problem. So now we said, let's take a step back. What are you looking to solve? You're looking to solve engineering velocity. Who's in charge of this? Your CIO, CTO, VP engineering? Let's give him a way to manifest this project, to effectively go and to have an on-demand agentic engineering org that he can go and summon, he or she can summon, and essentially go ahead and scale on-demand engineering capacity without needing to go into divert the attention of the existing capacity on hand.
Right, which I think is a key. I think when we were talking with all these platform engineers, a lot of it was, hey, we need some place where people can go and really self-service. But, you know, people want to interact in different ways and things like that, but funny enough, we're not getting 20% new engineering bodies brought in
Correct.
To go and solve for these AI complexities that we have here. How are you guys really approaching that where you can show people how they can get from, you know, POC to production with ROI?
I'll give even the most business business friendly attention. You're a head of an engineering org, and now your CFO office came to you and said, guess what? Your AWS bill is 20% more than your quota for this year. Now, you already have a roadmap 8 months figured out. You don't have the capacity. You may even be in an engineer in a headcount freeze, so you don't even have the extra capacity to deal with it. You know it's a top priority for the CIO on down, but it's not necessarily a top priority for the engineering org. How do you go and make that extra quota? So typically you'll have to go into hire, maybe even outsource some of that talent, onboard them, train them, get everybody up to speed. By that point, 6 months pass, 6 months of burn happen.
Yeah.
How do you actually do it without sacrificing that? Let's assume that same VP engineering now had Kubiya as an example and could go and prompt in the task in simple English, scan my entire AWS bill for the last 30 days, find underutilized resources for the last 30 days that are candidates for retirement and terminate those. Immediately, there's going to be an agentic project planner. Going to use a powerful model, of course, a thinking model. It's going to go and plan out the entire PRD. Here are the agentic teammates or the agentic engineers that are required. You may need a CISO org to go into approve retiring some of these resources. You may want to have compliance involved. You may want to have the platform engineer and the FinOps team involved, and all of those are costed out. Now you know exactly how long it's going to take this agentic engineering org to perform this end-to-end. It's going to know how much it's going to cost you in terms of token consumption, and you know if you want to approve it, at this point you get full visibility. It's a Kanban board that starts getting populated with tasks, and these tasks get solved with agents with the human in the loop. So every time there's a necessary human in the loop, you can go and approve those. So imagine a project that would have taken, this is a real project for one of our customers, a 3 month, 20 headcount project that would have taken them, and God knows how many hundreds of thousands of dollars, is taking them less than 3 hours.
Wow, that's
$27. Real stats.
Yeah, I think that type of improvement in velocity and efficiency is key, because I think a lot of people are looking at this going, okay, you know, maybe with things like that and tooling like that with Kubiya, they can get to a better than 95% failure rate. I mean, get
sure.
5%, or looking at possibly 5% success rate, getting to production. But one of the things that's interesting to me is in the customers you're talking to is that, again, they're looking at how they can treat AI and treat these applications as products. Because you bring up Kanban and PRDs and things mm-hmm. of that nature. Are you seeing that organizations are starting to mature their platform engineering teams that way? Because we heard that from some of the other larger companies, and we see it kind of seeming to trickle down.
I think maturity is all relative. I think we're still trying to find the motion where a self-service organization is in fact self-service. You may have reduced the need for 20 more engineers for capacity because you've introduced self-service, but you introduce those same 20 bodies on the platform engineering side to attend to those. So unless there's a true self-service way to automate not just middle-to-middle tasks, but end-to-end tasks, ones that require multiple data silos, multiple engineers, multiple individuals in the loop, may require a full process automation of 200 plus steps,
yeah,
thousands of tool calls in the agentic speak, and you could still perform those end-to-end. It's all because you knew how to break them down into tasks and how to introduce AI to expedite the velocity of these processes end-to-end.
And do you see that folks are trying to really drive their AI to, you know, again, solve task-oriented problems? Because we see this right now where we started with the generative AI and RAG and things of that nature. We've moved towards more agent-oriented types of deployments. And then we're getting to Agentic, which is several agents, maybe some real, you know, traditional AI type stuff or ML, and tied with things. How are people looking at that entire end-to-end process as they, because they're going through their journey, like you said, the maturity levels definitely vary in there.
Sometimes it helps to be early, sometimes it hurts. It's usually both. But one of the things that we've discovered, because we were early in this space, is just how looking at it as an agent or an agentic workflow isn't enough. You have to look at it as an end-to-end process that may involve deterministic workflows, that may involve agents that are non-deterministic that can go and take action. It may require some BI and some analytics on top of that. It may require bring in a human in a loop and bring in a compliance team and to actually go on to use infrastructure as code, because we all need to be grounded with the sound practices and respect the SDLC. All of that has to be true. It's not either or. Right. I think a lot of people are now starting to arrive at the bigger picture, and we're here to greet them in open arms, of course, to be a resource for them as well, to help them understand that when you look at it as you're not replacing engineers or the org, you're really introducing a new way to bring end-to-end engineering velocity to the organization, to augment the existing teams, and to really make everybody more successful.
Yeah, so as we look forward, you know, again, we're going to be back in Salt Lake a year from now.
Sure.
It'll probably be the same temperature as it is here in Atlanta this week. Probably with snow again, yeah. And what are you hoping that from here to, you know, a year from now, that you're going to be able to say that you can't say today about where Kubi is at, where your customer's at, where platform engineering is at?
We're blessed to say that we're in the process of very lucrative projects and contracts that were multi-year contracts that we're now signing out of Europe, out of US.
Congratulations.
Thank you very much. And I think that's going to help drive, going to give a North Star to the industry, that it's not too much to say that an autonomous or on-demand agentic engineering org is possible. I was almost taken back to not have to say it when we're introducing these concepts, because you always have to be sensitive to some of the political decisions in these organizations.
Yeah.
But we're not ashamed to say it anymore, because we're seeing the results in the field. We're having C-level, board-level discussions even with some of these companies, how this can be a real transformation for their competitive moat within their own respective industries, and we're very happy about that.
Yeah, well, I can't wait to have you and one of your customers who can come up here next year in Salt Lake.
Done.
Awesome, sounds good. Well, thank you for coming on board, really enjoyed this.
Thank you very much.
And thank you for watching this episode of KubeCon, CloudNativeCon, North America 2025 from moderately warm Atlanta. We'll see you soon.